I'm Norman Wildberger, and in this part of a series of foundational issues on mathematics, and in particular geometry, we're going to look at Book 5 of Euclid, which deals with proportions. The way the ancient Greeks thought about magnitude is quite different from the way we moderns think about it. And it's very instructive to see what Euclid was up to get a sense of alternate ways of thinking about mathematical reality. The ancient Greeks thought about magnitude as being the fundamental object of interest. And a magnitude was basically a geometrical object and characterized by the fact that there was no natural unit. We moderns tend to think as number is fundamental, essentially in an algebraic framework where there's a natural unit of the number one. The kinds of magnitudes that Euclid was interested in were things like length, and area, angle, and volume. And the ancient Greeks had some basic assumptions about these magnitudes that apply to any one of these situations. First of all, they assumed that given two magnitudes, and I'll suppose that we're talking about lengths to be explicit, but given any two magnitudes, we can always compare them and see whether they're equal, or whether A is less than B, or whether A is bigger than B. So in this case here, we can see that this magnitude A is less than this magnitude B. Another thing that we're always allowed to do is to form multiples. So if we're given the magnitude C, we are allowed to form the multiple 2C, or 3C, or any integral multiple of C. That was done in the Euclid's framework in terms of simple construction with the ruler and compass. The third point is that it's generally the proportions between magnitudes which is more important than the magnitudes themselves. So, given two magnitudes A and B, Euclid was primarily interested in the proportion between these two magnitudes. And this naturally leads to the idea of commensurability. So the ancient Greeks said that two magnitudes were commensurable if we could find a third magnitude such that both of the original two were multiples of that third one. So for example, if this is magnitude A and this is magnitude B, then if we take this little unit as say the third magnitude, then in terms of that one, A is 7 of those and B is 11 of the same. And so we can say that the proportion A to B is the proportion 7 to 11. And since we're allowed to make that third magnitude arbitrarily small, it's natural, very natural, to suppose that any two magnitudes are commensurable in this sense. It turns out that that's not true. That was quite a shock to the ancient Greeks. So this whole theory goes back to the Pythagoreans, the followers of Pythagoras. And they had an elaborate theory of how proportions between natural numbers could explain many aspects of the modern world, including the motion of the heavens and the theory of music. So for example, if you have two notes, then they are separated by what we call an octave if the guitar strings that are used to generate them are in the ratio 2:1, or in the proportion 2:1. So that's like Do, Do, from C to C. A perfect fifth is corresponding to the proportion 3:2. That's like Do to So. Do, Re, Mi, Fa, So, Do, So. That's a perfect fifth. Corresponds to C to G on the piano. A perfect fourth in the ratio 4:3. That's from Do to Fa. Do, Re, Mi, Fa. It's from C to F. A minor seventh, which goes from C to B flat, is the composition of two perfect fourths. And they realize that in order to get that proportion, you just multiply this proportion by itself. So the minor seventh is the proportion 16:9. However, there was a major difficulty with this idea of proportions as being the basis for everything. And that was illustrated by the famous discovery that if you take a square, and you take the diagonal of a square, then the side and the diagonal are not commensurable. That's a famous conundrum in mathematics, and it leads to the theory of irrational numbers. We now would say that a to b is in the proportion 1 to root 2, but the ancient Greeks didn't have a theory of things like root 2. There's also another manifestation of this kind of irrationality in what's known as the circle of fifths. If you go a perfect fifth up successively, then after 12 steps in our modern scale, you get back to where you started. And that corresponds to the fact that if you take 3/2, which is the proportion corresponding to a perfect fifth, then raise it to the 12th power, then you get something pretty close to 2^7, which is 7 octaves. But unfortunately, 2^7 is 128, which is a little bit different from this one. And so this discrepancy is the source of a lot of subtle difficulty in the theory of music, and has been for the last few thousands of years. Dealing with proportions that are commensurable is relatively easy. For example, if I have two magnitudes in the proportion 3/2, and you have two magnitudes in the proportion 6/4, we can easily decide that these proportions are actually the same, because 3 × 4 is equal to 2 × 6. So we would say in modern terms that these two ratios are the same. In abstract notation, A to B is equal to C to D, precisely when A times D equals B times C. And we can also express inequalities in the same framework. If we have numbers A to B, that proportion is going to be less than the proportion C to D, precisely when A times D is less than B times C. And similarly for greater than. But this kind of arithmetic only works for commensurable proportions, because we're multiplying numbers here. The question that Euclid had to surmount is, what happens if we are just given general proportions, not necessarily commensurable ones? For example, here's my proportion A to B, here's your proportion C to D. How do we tell if these proportions are the same? If they're not the same, how do we tell which one is bigger? That turns out to be a subtle problem. And it was solved by Eudoxus, and Euclid's Book 5 essentially gives Eudoxus' solution to this. Eudoxus was a great genius, and this theory is really quite a remarkable piece of work. Here is how he defined equality between two proportions, between magnitudes, even if those proportions were perhaps incommensurable. He said that A to B equals C to D precisely when, for any numbers, and when I say number, I mean natural number, like 1, 2, 3, 4. For any numbers m and n, if m times a equals n times b, then m times c equals n times d. And conversely. So in other words, if 3 times this one equals 2 times this one, and these proportions are the same, then it should be the case that 3 times this equals 2 times this. On the other hand, if 3 times this is less than 2 times this, then it should be the case that 3 times this is less than 2 times this. And if 3 times this is bigger than 2 times this, then 3 times this should be also bigger than 2 times this. So we need all of these conditions satisfied to conclude that A to B is equal to C to D. And these conditions have to be satisfied for all M and N. So it's a little bit complicated. And there's a corresponding definition for inequality of proportions as well. And Euclid uses this framework to derive various facts about proportions. For example, he shows that if this proportion is the same as this proportion, then if we look at A to B plus A, that's a new proportion, which will be equal to the proportion C to D plus C. In our next video, we're going to talk about the remaining books of Euclid, from book 6 to book 13. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.